many illnesses that she survived. And eventually they moved to Mendoza and she got better and from the tuberculosis. And then her father died. And so her mother at that stage had six children and no income. And so she moved to England. And her mother had a position with for 5 years as a stewardess. And it was a bit unusual in those days because normally women only worked at sea if they'd been the widows of seagoing officers. But at that stage as well, my father and his three brothers were put into an orphanage, and Vi was left to look after Eileen, who was a baby, and Vi was 16, and their mother went to sea to get an income. There was a small pension from the Argentinian railways. But eventually her mother was not well enough to keep going, and so Vi then became the breadwinner for the whole family, and she started her career at sea when she was 21.
And that was on the Titanic?
She sailed in various other ships. She came to the Titanic later, having sailed with other ships. And in her career, she really did about 190 different sailings with various lines. And she wasn't that keen on going on the White Star Line because she knew that it had a reputation in that its passengers were very, very demanding, mostly Americans. And she always liked Americans, and she found that they were very generous people, but they were had very high expectations of the service level that they wanted.
You and your cousins found Violet's memoirs, and you had them published. What do her memoirs reveal about her experience on the night that the Titanic sunk?
Well, she'd worked, she'd finished work, she'd actually gone down to her cabin, and stewardesses worked 17 hours a day for about £2.10 a month. That's what they earned, and they had to receive income from their tips, so it was really important that they provide good service. But she'd been given a prayer to read, a Hebrew prayer, and she was reading that. She was sort of settling, and then she heard the noise, and it was the noise of the ship hitting the iceberg. And she looked across to her cabin companion, who was another stewardess, and they both realised that something had happened, so she started to get dressed, and she went to look after her passengers for whom she was responsible. So she got them all onto the upper deck and made sure that they were all comfortable and waiting. She then went back down to her cabin and she started to pack up some things to take with her. And one of her bedroom stewards came down to look for the two women stewards, to say he couldn't find them. And so he said, come on, you've got to get moving. You've got to, don't worry about things, because Vi was there folding up her nightgown and so on. And he said, come on. And she said, well, I'll have to get better dressed. And he pulled out some clothes for her to wear. And she said, no, I can't wear that spring outfit. It's too bright and gay. And I can't wear that hat with pansies on it. That wouldn't be the right thing. So she put a scarf on, and she then locked the door of the cabin, and then she went to the deck, and from the deck she and her cabin companion, the other stewardess, Anne, were placed into one of the lifeboats, and that was principally with third class passengers, and they were all very upset, the women crying and so on. And Vi, having grown up in Argentina, spoke Spanish, so she was put in there to help calm them down. And just as they were lowering the lifeboat, a baby was thrust into her arms that had been left on the deck. And so she had to comfort the baby, and she was concerned that holding the baby against the hard canvas of the life jacket wasn't a cuddly embrace. And then they moved away from the ship, and Vi looked back, and she obviously, as did everyone, think that Titanic could not sink. And as she looked back, she started to count the lights and the rows of lights on the ship, and counted five, and then looked again and counted four, and so on. So they all realised, you know, it was that they realised that the ship was actually sinking. And then, of course, it she says there was a great sort of sigh as from people, and probably screams and so on, as then the ship slid into the water and then it was just still.
It's amazing hearing that story, to be honest. How long was she at sea before she was rescued in that rescue boat?
Oh, they were rescued the next day. They had one night, and fortunately it was very calm seas, and then they were picked up and they were rescued. And then, of course, the interesting thing people say to me is, why did she go back to sea? And my answer is, well, she was the breadwinner for her four brothers, her sister and her mother, and this was her the way she brought an income in. And I think it's interesting from our viewpoint looking back, and I think, as I said, for Vi, this was one episode in a lifetime of survival, is that if such an event happened today, we know that all the helping agencies would come in, and people would be getting trauma counselling, and social services would help. But there was nothing like that in those days. If you didn't look after yourself, and get back on the horse, if you liked, and she wanted to get back, she didn't want to be fearful of going back to sea, you were left by the wayside. And it's an interesting story in that all the stewards and the personnel had to buy their own uniforms. So she writes in her memoirs, Titanic Survivor, that some people thought that the crew had somehow done well from the sinking of the Titanic. And she said, well, that's just, you know, a ridiculous thought, because what happened, for example, was that the Telegraph newspaper gave each of the crew members £25, which was a lot of money, because they had to buy all their uniforms again. And then the mayor of Southampton called them down, sent out a message and asked them to come to Southampton, and he gave them each £10 to somehow help them. But then he found out that the newspaper had given them £25, so he got in touch with them all again and said, please come back and give the money back. And so she said she went back and gave the money back.